can in these current circumstances. Looking out across the congregation, I see many of you have already been to a Sunday service, so we'll know the COVID regulations, which are so important in these days, particularly as we see a spike in the communities around us. But I also see one or two who are here for the first time, which is wonderful. Welcome back to St. Peter's in this physical way. And so just a reminder with regards to our protocols, the most important thing is staying 1.5 metres away from one another. Spatial distancing is so important. So we observe that at all times during the service, and you'll see in the rubric that is outlined. So that means little things are changing, like we don't pass around the plate. There will be an offertory collection as a retiring collection today. Also, when you come for Holy Communion, please do make sure that when you queue, that you stay 1.5 metres away from each other, and then also likewise at the altar rail. At the end of the service, usually everyone is very well behaved and they put away their kneelers. I'm asking if you could be messy and leave your kneelers, please. That then means that the cleaners will know where to spot clean. We have a very deep clean once a week on Friday in preparation for the weekend, and then we have spot cleaning after every service or every gathering in church. And most important in all of this is, as we always do when we meet, is that we are aware that we are in the presence of God.
reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In those days, King Herod laid violent hands upon some who belonged to the church. He had James, the brother of John, killed with the sword. After he saw that it pleased some of the people, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. This was during the festival of unleavened bread. When he had seized him, he put him in prison and handed him over to 4 squads of soldiers to guard him, intending to bring him out to the people after the Passover. While Peter was kept in prison, the church prayed fervently to God for him. The very night before Herod was going to bring him out, Peter, bound with 2 chains, was sleeping between 2 soldiers, while guards in front of the door were keeping watch over the prison. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He tapped Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly," and the chains fell off his wrists. The angel said to him, "Fasten your belt and put on your sandals." He did so. Then he said to him, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." Peter went out and followed him. He didn't realize that what was happening with the angel's help was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. After they had passed the first and the second guard, they came before the iron gate leading into the city. It opened for them of its own accord, and they went outside and walked along a lane when suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hands of Herod and from all that the people were expecting." Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second letter of Paul to Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Hear the word of the Lord.
John Taff died last night, and rather than hearing it in the rawness of the intercessions where we will be praying for the repose of his soul, I thought that I would just make an announcement that our hearts are very much with Norman, with the family, with so many parishioners who have been so close to John over so many years, very much a pillar of St. Peter's. So before the reading of the Gospel, we just have a moment of silence as we give thanks for John's life.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John, chapter 21.
1, beginning at the 15th verse.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
After breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these others? Yes, Lord, he answered, you know that I love you. Then feed my lambs, he said. A second time he asked, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Then tend my sheep. A third time he said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt that he asked him a third time, do you love me? Lord, he said, you know everything. You know I love you. Jesus said, then feed my sheep. In very truth I tell you, when you were young, you fastened your belt about you and walked where you chose. But when you are old, you will stretch out your arms, and a stranger will bind you fast and carry you where you have no wish to go. He said this to indicate the manner of death by which Peter was glorified to God. Then he added, follow me. Peter looked around and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following, the one who at supper had leaned back close to him to ask the question, Lord, who is it that will betray you? When he saw him, Peter asked, Lord, what about him? Jesus said, if it should be my will that he stay until I come, what is that to you? Follow me. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. It is indeed very wonderful to be here with you at St. Peter's for your patronal festival, physically present with those able to be here, also with those joining us on live stream, and I believe also on YouTube. When Father Hugh invited me, we were imagining the usual large celebration. Little did we know what was around the corner, little did any of us. And I want to take the opportunity this morning to say how wonderful it is the way St. Peter's Eastern Hill, with Father Hugh's leadership, has been able to move online, continuing to be a civic presence for worship. For worship here, gathering as the people of God, but also worship in the sense of being present for the vulnerable in our community, through AngriCare Victoria's Lazarus Centre, which of course has been so, its genesis and support is through here, and also Heaven on a Hill. So many parishes have greatly appreciated being able to access those meals and be able to help the vulnerable in their community in wider parts of Melbourne, and also what it modelled. And also I want to say, of course, the ongoing presence of Alive at the university ministry at RMIT in a time of great uncertainty. I particularly have investment in that one, Alive, because my son is going to RMIT next year, so just thought I'd let you know. Times of crisis, being present in the midst of crisis. It's in these times, as hard and as challenging as they are, that the church is helped, I believe, to recover its vocation. It's in these times particularly, I think, that we gain a clear sense of purpose. We see it in our gospel today, the exchange between Jesus and St. Peter, the patron saint of this church. What we see more than anything else is love is at the heart of our vocation, at the heart of our calling, of what it means to be God's people, the church, the body of Christ. Do you love me? Do you love me? That is what Jesus really wants to know. No more, no less. That is what Jesus simply wants to know. No more, no less. Whatever our challenges, whatever our failures, do you love me? Today's gospel takes place a few days after the resurrection. The disciples must have been in a state of shock. They were in a time of great change. And the hardest thing with that, of course, is the uncertainty, as Hugh will testify, planning this patronal festival amidst constantly changing government restrictions. For St. Peter, it was the risen Lord turning up here and there, no telling when it might be, and no telling where it might be next. No wonder Peter has said, in effect, earlier in the chapter, I've got to get out of here. His exact words were, I'm going fishing. The uncertainty of the unexpected of change. For Peter, it is also about guilt and shame, isn't it? When the Lord was raised from the tomb, the gospel accounts suggest strongly that joy is uppermost for Peter. But it must have, that joy, that feeling of joy, must have also been mingled considerably with feelings of dread as well. Remember, it was Peter who said on that very same shore at an earlier time, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. And if any proof of that were needed, Peter had certainly given it. Peter was guilty of one of the worst things a human being can do to another, let alone to the Son of God. He denied Christ three times. Peter must have understood that Jesus forgave him, being of Saviour that Peter knew him to be. But how was Peter ever going to hold his head up again, to get over the shame? We can imagine Peter has had a hard time eating his breakfast of fish and bread there on the beach with the man whose love and trust he had denied him, because he choked on the food. The words of Gerard Van Hopkins in one of his sonnets describe it perfectly: God's most deep decree, bitter would have me taste. My taste was me. So Jesus now, in his third appearance to the disciples, is now tying up an important loose end. What was the future for Peter? Was Jesus still prepared to forgive Peter? So John is tying up this loose end, the gospel writer. Can there be any future now for Peter as one of Jesus' followers? Can there be any future for us when we fail, when we struggle? We pick up this morning when they'd finished breakfast. Jesus turns to Peter and, using the form of his name that he used at the very beginning, when he called the big fisherman from his nets, maybe to distance him a little as if to test him, more likely to remind Peter of when Jesus first called him to be his disciple. Jesus says to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" More than these? What does Jesus mean by that? It can be interpreted in different ways, but most commentators find the meaning in the earlier protest of Peter when he said, "Even though all these others will leave you, I never will." When Jesus says, "Do you love me more than these?" he's picking up Peter's boast that he loves more than the others. Peter then responds simply, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." There's no doubt of St. Peter's sincerity here. The human being may be cowardly, may be devious, may be desperately corrupt, as the prophet Jeremiah says, but if the heart is turned toward Jesus, that you love him, that is the sign that the Lord's redemption is at work. When Peter says this, Jesus replies to him, "Feed my lambs." Then after a little while, Jesus said to him again, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter said, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Tend my sheep." Jesus said to Peter the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" This time, we're told, Peter was terribly hurt, terribly hurt. It's actually very rare that we're told anything in the Bible about a person's inner feelings. So this is a very striking statement. What more can Peter say? The distress with which he replies must have registered with the Lord, for Jesus doesn't ask him a fourth time. Third and final exchange goes like this. Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." Peter denied Jesus three times. Now Jesus asks Peter to declare his love three times. Each time, then Jesus says the same thing in three different ways. "Feed my lambs. Tend my sheep. Feed my sheep." So Peter is not only forgiven, you see, he's completely made new, to use the word of the Apostle Paul, whose feast day is also today, Peter and St. Paul, he's justified. He too is raised from the dead, and he comes forth to us as a man recreated. He is now to carry the divine life of Jesus to others. He is given his commission. Jesus entrusts him with the pastoral future of the Christian community in the same terms that Jesus used of himself in John chapter 10. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. So Peter's apostolate will be that of Jesus himself. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. And we know from our Acts reading today that even before that, Peter experienced many challenges and imprisonment. Then Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Can there be any future now for Peter as one of Jesus' followers? Is there any future for us when we fail to keep our baptismal promises? The answer is yes. And not just yes, but I won't trust you with anything more now. It's yes, feed my sheep. Follow me. At our last synod, the Archbishop spoke of longing for a culture that is resilient because it's founded on the completely reliable character of God and the divine revelation to us of the incarnation, ministry, crucifixion, and resurrection of Jesus, his life, death, and resurrection. This is the faith that has inspired the martyrs of the church since the days of Jesus himself. And let me say today that this is the faith which will inspire you at each point of failure, at each point of challenge, to, with St. Peter, rest in the love of Jesus. Because we see in today's gospel that there is no crime so atrocious, no shame so abysmal, no failure so profound as to put us beyond the transforming power of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, we are already incorporated in his risen divine life. This is what gives us strength and courage, the resilience to get up from our pain and sorrow, our shame and disgrace, our sin and perversity, to go forth in the power of the Spirit as new creatures in Christ Jesus. Simon, son of John, do you love me? Each of us here, present physically, present online, each of us are being asked the same question by our Lord through the power of the living word. Let's be praying especially now in all we face in the midst of COVID-19 and beyond, that we will have that resilience, the faith, through the faith that inspired St. Peter and all the early church, as we are motivated by and joined together in love. May we, with St. Peter, be able to answer, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." May we, with St. Peter, answer Jesus' call on our lives to have the courage to be the people, the church, God is calling us today. To be able to say with St. Paul, "We have run the race, fought the good fight, finished the race." That we can say that for the sake of those Jesus is calling us feed, to tend. As Peter is reminded, it will look different for each of us. He says, "Don't worry about John, worry about yourself." But we are all called to follow Jesus, to share in words and action the love of Jesus with those in need of his love.
God of grace, you chose your servant Peter to be the rock on which the church was built. We give thanks to the church across the ages. In our own age, we pray for a church resilient and creative in facing the challenge and change of the pandemic. We pray for Archbishop Philip, our regional Bishop Genevieve with us today, Father Yu, and all the clergy and laity who lead our parish ministry and mission. Fill us with your spirit, that we, like St. Peter, may find courage to proclaim the gospel despite our human frailty. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, you chose your servant Peter to proclaim the gospel of hope. We pray for an end to hatred and intolerance in our city, our nation, and our world. We pray for an end to hurtful, racist, homophobic, and sexist attitudes. We pray for our federal, state, and local governments, and all those who lead us. Lord, in your mercy, loving God, you chose your servant Peter to bring healing to the world. We pray for all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, especially in this time of pandemic. We lift before you in prayer those close to us and all those on the parish prayer list who have asked for our prayers. Aidan McCann, David Bornstein, Margaret Brown, Terry Cutler, Alice McCraith, Don Edgar Priest, Bradley James, Grace James, Margaret Lugg, Lynn Nicholas, John Small, Margaret Sutherland, Evelina Thornton, John Walden Small, Paul Wilton, and George. Lord, in your mercy, loving God, we give you thanks for St. Peter, St. Paul, and your faithful servants in every age. With the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, may they ever inspire us into deeper devotion and sacrificial giving of our lives for others. We remember those who grieve and pray for the recently departed, John Tack, and for those whose year's mind occurs today, Robert Banks Priest. Rest eternal grant to them, O Lord.
And to God, thank you,
Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers.
Grant the Lord our hearts and prayers. We may have our grace to receive through Jesus Christ our Lord.
We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Peter and all the saints in faith and hope and love. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you all.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to